Before you can even begin to start working with color correction, you must have your monitor calibrated. If you don't understand what I'm on about or why it's important, click the link below to the monitor calibration film where everything will be explained and I'll tell you what kind of equipment you need. But in brief, why it's important is that if your monitor isn't displaying colors accurately, how can you possibly correct them accurately? They might look okay on your monitor, but if you send them to someone else, what are they going to look like when they get there? Now, I know you can't guarantee that someone else's monitor is corrected, but at least if yours is, and someone comes back to you and says, this picture's a funny color, you can with confidence tell them that it's their monitor, not your image. There are two branches to color correction, as far as I'm concerned, and that is color accuracy, such as you would need for a product. Someone has manufactured something, a chef has cooked something, they want that to appear in images as they made it. So color accuracy is very, very important. But then you also have what looks pleasing, because accurate may not necessarily look pleasing. Let's have a look at accurate first. So in my trusty Photoshop here, I have got an image which I shot for an electronics manufacturing company only last week. You'll notice that down here in the bottom left-hand corner is my trusty grey and white card, which I often bang on about in films. So why would I go such a stupid thing as to put it in the photograph? Well, I know that this is white, beyond any shadow of a doubt. So logic dictates that if I make what's in here match what's in my hand, then the colours in the rest of the picture will be accurate. Clever thinking, eh? Also, the way I work in a controlled environment. By that I mean the light in here is daylight balanced. There are no tungsten bulbs which give you yellowy colour casts. Everything here is daylight balanced. So therefore, what I'm looking at in my hand is the correct colour. If I had tungsten lights in here, this would have a yellowy colour cast, and I would never in a million years be able to get that to match that and have the colours accurate. The most important reason for using one of those would be if you're using a RAW processor, which I would generally do for a shoot of this type. With a RAW processor, you can take a little dropper tool, click it onto the white area of the card, and then that will correct that to white. You have to be sure that your white really is a genuine clean white, though, spectrally accurate to do that. But more on that in a different film. We're going to do this longhand. Now, I don't suppose for a moment you are working in the same controlled environment that I am, so this should be helpful to you at the very least. The place I would always begin is with the auto adjustment. So let's go to auto color, run that, and in this case, I think it's done a stunning job. If I flick between the two, I don't know if you can see this in the video, because subtleties of color hue sometimes get lost when we're compressing video for the web. But you can download these images so you can compare them next to one another. And if you look at a picture which says that, which the file name says has been corrected, and you see it as having a funny color cast or looking wrong, your monitor needs calibrating. Okay. Let's put this back to the beginning again and do it the long way. We go image, adjustments, color balance. Now the color balance palette has got these three little boxes which currently have zeros in them. They will change according to what you do with these three sliders. Now these sliders are for the three main colors which you have when displaying an image. Well, actually they are the three primary colors you have when you're looking at an image. Red, green and blue. And their opposites, cyan, magenta, and yellow. Now this image has got a bit of green going on in it. So what we need to do is to remove green. And to do that, I would push this middle slider here away from green and towards magenta. And as I go, so the greeny cast is coming out. I'm hoping you can see it. That's about right there. Good. Looking below there, we also have this tone balance area. This you can say here that you can want to work in shadow areas, mid-tone areas, which we just have done, and highlight areas. There is also this little tick box here which says preserve luminosity. This is very important and always keep it ticked. Our eyes perceive colours differently to the way they actually are. For example, magentas often appear to be quite dark. It makes a picture look dark if you add magenta. It isn't dark, it's just the way different light wavelengths are picked up by our eyes. by clicking preserve, by keeping preserved luminosity ticked, Photoshop very, very cleverly preserves that brightness as you add and subtract different colours to get your colour balance right. This is one which works well, so always keep it ticked. Okay, we've worked in the mid-tones. We've got it much closer now. Looking at my card here, I'd say there's still a slight subtle greeny tinge going on in there. And there certainly is across the top of the pinpoint machine here. So let's go into highlights and take a little bit more green out. We're just going to ease that across to magenta and just looking at the picture as I do it. And this is going to be subtle. Highlight areas really do pick up colour casts. So we want to be subtle with this. 10, yeah, that looks good to me. But now I've done this, I have added a little bit of sort of pinkiness to it. Interestingly, this dark area of the picture doesn't look quite right to me. It looks as though it's got a little bit of pink in it. So I'm going to click onto the shadow radio button, and I'm going to do something which might seem ludicrous. I'm going to put some green back in. Somehow, around the highlight running down here, it's kind of picked up a little bit of the pink. So I'm just going to put the tiniest little hint of green back in, but only in the shadow area, the black area, so it doesn't affect the bright bits, which will hopefully counteract it. Yeah, I can see it. You probably can't see that in the video, but that has pulled that black back to being black. I've only added 8. It's a tiny amount, but it is accurate. Okay, so this is looking to be the correct colour. Now what you're probably thinking to yourselves is, okay, Mr. Smartass, how are you going to get those settings onto another picture which I shot at the same time and doesn't have the card in it? I forgot to load that in to show you just now, but never mind. We're going to transcribe those settings using the good old-fashioned longhand method of pen and paper. It's as simple as that. I love low-tech stuff. It's actually my favourite sort of way of going about anything. So all I have to do is write shadows plus 8 green. Click on the midtones button, read it off. Mids minus 31 green. Highlights minus 10 green. So now I've got it on my notepad, I can just click cancel out of there. This goes back to being green again. Go and get the shot which doesn't have the card in it. Image. Adjustments, colour balance, and all I've got to do is to pop those settings in there. So the shadows are plus 8 green. Push that across here until we get 8 in the box. 9, 7, 8, there we go. Midtones were minus 31 green. Ease that across there. 35, 29, yeah, I'll get it in a minute. Oh, it's tricky. And the highlights were minus 10 green. So there we go. I have just pushed that across because in this second image, I shot it in the identical light. Almost immediately, I had taken the other image with the card in it. And if we put those side by side, I think you'll be able to see there is a big difference in the colours. I'm going to save this up as a copy so that you can have a look for yourself. But first, I just want to show you how the software can get it wrong. So here's a picture I took at a wedding of a prawn cocktail. Well, what else would you photograph at a wedding, for goodness sake? You can see it's very, very yellowy pink. That's because there was lots of tungsten light. The overhead lights were tungsten. That's that colour you get in the living room at home when the flash doesn't go off. Things go yellow, don't they? I liked the light and I didn't want to use a flash because it would make all this background go really, really dark. Possibly. But also, I like the quality of the light, but I don't like the colour of the light. They're two very different things. Let's just run the auto adjustments, auto colour. If I flick back and forth between the two, you can see it hasn't preserved luminosity. The colours are a bit better, but it's made it look dark. So there you go. This is where the technology can't always be relied upon. So we'll have to do this longhand. I'm only going to do it very quickly because you kind of should have got the idea from what I was doing just now with the other image. But this is obviously very, very red, so we're going to pull a lot of red out of there by pushing in magenta, into cyan. There's a lot of yellow in there, so we're going to push in some blue. That's starting to look better already. The highlights, they got lots of red and yellow in there. So again, be a bit more subtle with the highlights. Just take that down a bit. Yeah, and a little bit of blue into there. That's better. And the shadows too. We're going to take a bit of red out of them and put a bit of blue into them. If I preview that, I think even in the video, you can see an enormous difference in that image. Now, I would probably fiddle with it a little bit longer than that to try and get it absolutely accurate, but it's enough for you to see what I mean. Finally, I just want to talk to you about pleasing, because that's a very different thing. Accurate may not be pleasing. This is a portrait I shot of Lucy and Andy. I did their wedding 11 years ago, and last year I did these shots for them when they asked me to do a 10th anniversary photo shoot. I've chosen this image because it's actually fairly accurate in its colour, but it isn't pleasing. When you shoot in shade, as I was there, there is often a bit of a bluey colour cast going on. You can counteract that by changing the white balance settings in your camera, but it is so easy to forget to do it when you're caught up in the moment. You're saying, right, Lucy, this way a bit, Andy, this way a bit, you know, come on, cheer up, look human, and all that stuff. Those colours are fairly accurate. If I run the auto adjustment, auto colour, and flick between them, I don't even know if you'll see that in the video at all. It does improve it a bit, but even with it on the accurate, I still don't think that's particularly pleasing. I think Andy looks a bit blue. It looks like he's just come back from an expedition to the North Pole, poor man. So let's go into it and let's make this pleasing rather than accurate. Colour balance. It's exactly the same thing, only now we're looking for what looks nice. But again, don't forget, if you're doing this for someone else, you've got to make sure your monitor's the right colour, because you're on a hiding to nowhere if it isn't. Let's see, I'm going to work in the mid-tones first. I want to put some red in there. So we're going to push the slider towards the red, get some reds going on. Nice, warm, luxurious sort of red happening. And I'm going to put a bit of, take some blue out and put a little bit of yellow in there, because that again will kind of really lift it up. If I do the preview, I think even the video, you can see a change straight away. Let's go to the highlights. I'm just going to do the same thing, but more subtly with the highlights. And with the shadows. That's looking much nicer. When I go with the preview, I think, and even in the video, you can see that's gone from quite a cold, not very pleasing look to a much warmer one. But in this case, the warmer one is probably not accurate, but it does look nicer. Again, I'll save this up for you in a moment so you can have a look at it. So there you go, little recap. You have accurate for products. You then have pleasing, which works well for people and for landscapes and things like that. It might be a bit of a dull day, which is making things look blue and awfully lifeless, but you can bring them to life by punching in a little bit of warmth, a little bit of yellow and a little bit of red, and a little bit of goldy sort of stuff going on in there. And finally, don't forget to calibrate your monitor.